Okay, 2 weeks in a row.
No, very
Been
good.
able to at least get the recording started and
Yeah.
stopped. Well, good morning, everybody, both here around the table and those of you that have joined us by Zoom and those that will catch us on YouTube. Glad you're with us. It is Saturday, August the 3rd. August the 3rd.
It's always fun if you like what read the dailies, right? You get to the third, it's the last thing you have to put a comma after three.
Yes,
Yeah. No. And so you like see how
exactly.
fast time's being like, oh, we're already there. Yeah, no
Yeah.
more commas.
Yeah. And
It's not a big deal to add the comma, but it's just like oh.
I forgot yesterday and didn't. And then all of a
Yeah.
sudden all the 20s
Yeah.
and the seconds came up. Forget that ever so often, but glad everybody's here. Let's go ahead and do our entering in prayer. And I'm going to, if I can, just put it up on the screen here. For those that may not, let me move this out of the way. Yeah. Okay, everybody see that all right? For those that don't know it by heart, in the name of the Father, and the Son, and the Holy Spirit, amen. Come to thy will, come to reign in thee.
With this one act, I want to embrace my entire day. I want to embrace every thought, every word, every action, and all the people I meet, the things I have to do, all my duties. I want all to be in your most holy will. I want to put my whole day right from this instant in your most holy will. So that should I be distracted, or should there be things I forget, they may all be done in your will. Amen. Come, Holy Spirit, fill the hearts of your faithful, and enkindle in them the fire of your love. Send forth your Spirit, and they shall be created, and you shall renew the face of the earth. Remember your congregation, which you have blessed from the beginning. O Lord, hear my prayer, and let my cry come unto you. The Lord be with you, and with your spirit. Let us pray. O God, who has taught the hearts of the faithful by the light of the Holy Spirit, grant us in the same spirit to be truly wise and to ever rejoice in this holy consolation. We ask this through Christ our Lord. Amen.
In the name of the Father, and the Son, and the Holy Spirit. Amen. Okay. Now I'm going to open up this next one, if I can do it right. Bear with me a second. My mouse is not working too good on my mouse pad.
Marge John Julio wanted me to tell everybody hello in this group. I saw her at church the other day.
Oh, really?
Yeah.
Tommy said hi, too.
Yeah.
Okay, here we go. Go down just a minute. You know, I think everybody that's on the Zoom today was here last week and has been here for the last several weeks. And you know, there in many times, both the business world and the sports world, especially in the sports world, you hear more about this, where you've got this coach that's been, you know, so successful over years and years and years, whether it be somebody like Lou Saban at Alabama or Bear Bryant again at Alabama or Joe Paterno at Penn State, or Pat Summitt at Tennessee, who, for those that know women's basketball, and the press is always about who's going to be the next coach? How are they going to be able to do to follow in those footsteps? So as I went through this week, putting this together, and Mary and I had a couple of calls, I'm sitting there going, you know, I'm having to follow Paula after these last 8, 9, 10, 11 weeks, and heart and heartbeat. And you know, it's like the new coach coming in after the big coach leaves and whatnot. So y'all just bear with me if I, you know, if we're not quite in the same vein as what Paula brought us to. But Paula, thank you again for all the work that you did over the last several weeks on Heart and Heartbeat. But what we wanted to do as our next step here in the cynical was to talk a little bit about action. Mary left last week or was talking about it the week before and last week, and we were, how can we do, maybe convert a little bit into some action? And so what we're going to try to do is talk about that action of giving our fiat. We're going to read some readings here. I'm going to go through this chart real quick. This chart is more for you guys to have if you want to print it out and stick it in your materials that you carry around, just to have as a reference. That's fine. That's all this is for primarily. But the thinking is, as we give our fiat, what are the things that are going on as we're giving it? What are some of the things that are happening? How do we give our fiat and then take action in it? What does that mean? So what this first page is here is at the top with the little yellow section, what I wanted to do is these are many things that we've talked about before, but it's basically walking from Genesis 1:26 through some of the materials that we've talked about it, both in scripture and the Book of Heaven and the Catechism. And hopefully it'll make sense I am going to kind of walk through this section. But then the five readings at the bottom are talking about giving our fiat and what happens around the giving of fiat. And those are going to be our first five readings, but we'll go further down into this document to get to the actual words themselves. So that's kind of where we're heading and what we're trying to do. And obviously, as always, questions, please ask. Comments, points that you're trying to get to yourself, let's talk through them as we go through it. But this section in yellow is kind of a combination and then a little bit of an addition to our normal route of starting out with scripture and then going to the catechism and going to the readings. So what I did here was I took all three. We're not going to read the readings that are in the Book of Heaven, just the excerpt here that are that's included. But if we go back to Genesis and 1:26, and we've talked about this so many times, and it's kind of the essence of Adam before the fall and where we were. Let us make man. And then God said, "Let us make man in our image, after our likeness." And we've also talked about image and likeness being two separate and distinct meanings and two separate and distinct I'll say relations with God. And when we think of it in those terms and then follow through with the catechism and then some of the writings that Jesus has given to us, it breaks that out further. And Catechism 705 is kind of the next step. Disfigured by sin and death, man remains, that's what happened with the fall, right? Man became disfigured by sin and death. Man remains in the image of God, in the image of the Son, but is deprived of the glory of God, of his likeness. The promise made to Abraham inaugurates the economy of salvation, at the culmination of which the Son himself will assume the image and restore it in the Father's likeness, by giving it again its glory, the Spirit. Oh, I can't see that section. Who is
the giver of life?
We've got a little pictures of everybody up here. but the point being is there that this restoration, this context of restoration, and there is, you can look in the catechism and look up restoration, and there's conversation in there about man being restored to where he was before the fall. Matthew 6, 9 through 13, is the Our Father, where it's the only prayer that Jesus has given us. It's the, of all the prayers that are out there that we pray, this is the one that Jesus told us to pray. And pray then like this, Our Father who art in heaven, hallowed be thy name. Thy kingdom come, thy will be done on earth as it is in heaven. Give us this day our daily bread, and forgive us our trespasses, as we forgive those who trespass against us. And lead us not into temptation, but deliver us from evil. And I, when I have conversations and I talk about the divine will, I will tend to lead in with it's the coming to fruition of the first thing we ask for in the Our Father. You know, Our Father is a recognition of who God is, who art in heaven, is where he is all around us. And hallowed be thy name, is that's giving him the recognition that he deserves. And then we ask for the kingdom to come, the will to be done on earth as it is in heaven. So in the Book of Heaven, in the February 24th, 1933 reading, Jesus tells Louisa about his kingdom coming and his will being done. If it were impossible that my will could reign on earth as in heaven, I want to read your mind here. My all-paternal goodness would not have taught the prayer of the Our Father, because to make impossible things prayed for, I would not have done, nor would I have recited it with so much love as first, placing myself at the head of all. Nor would I have taught it to the apostles so that they could teach it to the whole world as the most beautiful and most substantial prayer of my church. So this is also kind of a little bit of a timeline in our timing of getting to the point of giving and giving our fiat. And then in Catechism 51, it pleased God in his goodness and wisdom to reveal himself and make known the mystery of his will to be done on earth as it is in heaven. His will was that men should have access to the Father through Christ, the Word made flesh, in the Holy Spirit, and thus become sharers in the divine nature. Kind of, I'm trying to walk forward, right, with the loss of the likeness to God, to Jesus implementing the Our Father. 1 second, we need to let one more person in here, sorry. To the Our Father of on earth as it is in heaven. And so his will being done. So what is his will? His will is this restoration. The latter part of this is restoration back to being sharers in the divine nature. And then in the Book of Heaven, in November 22nd, 1925, Jesus says to Louisa, "And if the task of the soul is to live in my will, the task of mine is to give my likeness to the human will in a perfect way." So we're continuing, he's acknowledging what's in the catechism, as well as how that comes to relate to the Book of Heaven earlier. And then throwing in Matthew here, 24:14, "And the gospel of the kingdom will be preached throughout the world as a witness to all nations, and then the end will come." Following that, the Book of Heaven, August 23, 1928, "The truths about my fiat are the new gospel of the kingdom of my divine will." The truths about my fiat are contained where? They're contained in the Book of Heaven, in which they will find the norms, the sun, the teachings on how to ennoble themselves, to elevate themselves to their origin, and to take the state given to them by God at the beginning of creation. And then September 17th, 1924, which we've read through many times as well, "I bless these writings from the heart. I bless every word. I bless the effects and the value they contain. These writings are part of myself." So in this yellow section, it's just what I was trying to do is kind of just work through a progression of where we're now at the point of having the Book of Heaven and all that is the truths and knowledges that are contained in them. And they are so great and grand and become even deeper, the more that we learn, the more we know about these knowledges and bring them in. And as is the mission, obviously, of our cynical here, is to take these knowledges and pull them into our actual operating self, how we live as in our souls as humans. And then by giving our human will back to the Father, place it at the foot of the throne of the Father, and then take the next step into operating in God's will, which is as it's done on in heaven, then what's our first step? It's giving our fiat. I mean, we come to these meetings. We've all done this. We've come to these meetings. We've been here for some period of time. We've taken it in. We've learned. We've tried to understand hey, what's going on with this? And then all of a sudden it strikes us, right? It strikes us all. And then at some point after that, we make that decision to where we want to give our will to God. We want, and we're serious about it. We're not talking about, you know, I want to do your will. It's like, I want to live from you. I want to operate from your will. And I'm going to, and my intention, as we learned in the very first reading of the second volume, our intention is to be moment by moment by moment, every day, every moment, consistently. And so how does that happen, or how do we do that? And so that's kind of where we're going to go into these blue sections and the writings afterwards. I've talked. Would you like to add a little something on that at all?
You're doing great. You're
anybody great. Else? I'm going to stop there. But if anybody has any other comments they might like to throw in, please do so. Feel free to do so. Okay, so I'm going to scroll down. And again, this first page is more, as I see it, is that kind of that pathway, that walkway to giving the fiat, and things that tell us that this is what we're knowing we're called to do. And we have more than five writings, but to me, these are the kind of the first five that I've looked through and said, I'd like to kind of take these in order to talk them through. And because they build on each other or reinforce each other. And I'm not going to do anything with this now, but if you, again, feel like you want to print it out and hang on to it and refer to it, that's really the point of this particular page. For those of you on Zoom, this next two pages I'm going to go through, because this is what I normally put together just as a summary of every week's writings, except for Paula's, because that would have taken about 15 pages anyway, but that's okay. And let's go to our first reading, if anybody doesn't have any question. And that's in volume 30, March 20th, 1932. It is, there's a lot of knowledge and information in here. First is about the conditions to obtain the kingdom. And then he goes into a conversation about living in it. That I think is extremely relevant and very visual about how you can get that sense of it. Would someone like to read this reading?
I'm happy to. We're doing the
whole reading. Okay. We're doing the whole reading.
All right. March 20th, 1932. Three necessary conditions in order to obtain the kingdom of the divine will. How everyone lives in the divine will, different ways of living. I was thinking of the divine will, and I said to myself, if our Lord so very loves to make known a volition so holy and wants that he reign in the midst of creatures, why then does he want that one prays in order to obtain it? While one time that he wants it, he can also give it without so much as anyone praying for it. And my sweet Jesus, surprising me, said to me, my daughter, knowing my divine will is the greatest thing that I can give and the creature can receive.
Can you stop there? Would you start with just that last little bit right there? Just to reinforce what he said.
My daughter, knowing my divine will is the greatest thing I can give and the greatest the creature can receive.
Okay, thank you.
Absolutely. And his reigning is the confirmation of his great gift. It is the carrying out of his known will. Hence, it is necessary to ask for him, With asking for him, the creature disposes herself for it. She forms in herself the palace where to receive him. In asking for him, she acquires the love in order to love him. She acquires the dowries of sacrifice that is needed in order to possess them. And as she asks, the human volition loses its ground, is weakened, loses strength, and is disposed to receive the dominion of the supreme volition. And God, seeing himself prayed to dispose himself to give it. The dispositions are needed on both parts in order to give our celestial gifts. How many gifts we want to give, but because we are not asked, we retain them in ourselves, waiting to give them when we will be asked. Asking is as if it might happen to open commerce between the creator and the creature. If she does not ask, the commerce is closed, and our celestial gifts don't descend in order to put themselves in circuit upon the earth, the face of the earth. Hence, the first indisposable necessities in order to obtain the kingdom of the divine will is to ask for it with incessant prayers. Because as one prays, thus the little letters arrive to us, now with solicitudes, now with supplications, now with a cord that want to have to do our will, until the last letter will arrive with the final accord.
Hold on 1 second. For all of us that have been in, but not only this cynical, but any other cynicals who may have been in conferences, there's always that common, this common summary of this paragraph, which is all you have to do is want it. All you have to do is ask for it. It's as simple as that. He makes it that simple.
The second necessities, more indispensable than the first in order to obtain this kingdom, is that it is necessary to know what can be had. Who can ever think of a good, desire it, love it, if she doesn't know that she can obtain it? No one. If the ancients might not have known that the future Redeemer should come, nobody would have given thought, nor would have prayed, nor hoped for salvation, because the salvation, the sanctity of those times remained fixed, centralized in the future celestial Savior. Outside of this, there was no hope for some good. To know that one can have a good forms the substance, the life, the food of that good in the creature. Behold, therefore, the so many knowledges on my will that I have manifested to you, so that it can be known that they can have the kingdom of the divine will. When one knows a good can be had, the arts are used, the industries and the means are undertaken in order to obtain the intent.
Stop 1 second. It can be given. I want it, and the Trinity wants to give it.
Right.
The second.
The third necessity means is to know that God wants to give this kingdom. This casts the foundations, the certain hope in order to obtain it, and forms the last preparations in order to receive the kingdom of the divine will. For a good that one wants and longs for, to know that who can give it already wants to give it, it can be called the last blow of grace and the final act in order to obtain that which one wants. If, in fact, I might have manifested to you that I can give and want to give my divine will dominating and reigning in the midst of creatures, you would have been indifferent like all the others for a good so great, so that your interest, your prayers would have had the effects and parts of that which you had known.
Last interruption for a little bit of time. We've spoken of this. It's in a lot of our materials, and it's one of the foundations. All you have to do is ask for it. All you have to do is believe that the Trinity wants to give it, and believe that the Trinity can give it. I think I swap those. They can give it, and they want to give it. when you're of that frame of reference and mind, then you are significantly disposed towards these writings and for understanding what's in them, and ultimately for finding yourself in very not too distant steps of saying, I want this for myself, and I know that you can give it to me, and I want to go down that trail. I want to sign on. I want to come to learn and understand the knowledges, and I am disposed, and I want to be a part of this.
And I love that it also says, a good that one wants and yearns for can be called the last flow of grace.
Yes.
Oh, and the final act in order to obtain what he wants. The last flow of grace.
The last flow of grace. So that your interests, your prayers have been effects and part of that which you have known. And I myself, when I came upon the earth in the 30 years of my hidden life, it can be said that I apparently didn't do good to anyone, nor did anyone even know me. I remained in the midst of them unobserved. The whole good was developed between me and the celestial father, my celestial mother, and dear Saint Joseph, because they knew who I was. All the others knew nothing. Instead, when I went out from my hideaway and openly made myself known, saying that I really was the promised Messiah, their Redeemer and Savior, and although with having made myself known, I attracted on me calamities, persecutions, contradictions, anger, hatred of the Hebrews, and of the passion and death myself. All these evils that as copious rain rained on me had the beginning of making myself known. I affirm that which I really was, the eternal word, descended from heaven in order to save them. So very true that even when I was in the house of Nazareth, not knowing who I was, no one said anything of me, nor did they slander me, or did they hurt me. As I revealed myself, all the evils fell on me. But this was necessary to make myself known. Otherwise, I would have left again for heaven without completing the purpose for which I came upon the earth. Instead of making myself known, in spite that I attracted so many evils, in the midst of this abyss of evils, I formed my apostles, announced the gospel, worked prodigies, and my knowledge instigated my enemies to make me suffer so many sufferings, even to give me death on the cross. But I obtained my intent so that many would know me in the midst of so many that didn't want to know me, and to complete my redemption. I knew that with making myself known, the perfidy and pride of the Hebrews would have done so much, but it was necessary to make myself known, because a person, a good, if it isn't known, is not the bearer of life nor of good. The good, the truths not known, remain impeded in itself without fecundity. I'm sorry, as it was so sterile mothers that finished with their generation. You see, therefore, how necessary it is that one knows that I can give the kingdom of my will and that I want to give it. I can say that there enters the same necessity as to make known that I was the Son of God, that I came upon the earth. And it's also true that with so many knowing this, repeat what they did to me when I was made known who I was, the longed for Messiah. Calamities, contradictions, doubts, suspicions, contempts, as already they have done, there was hardly the beginning of the printing that mentioned to make my divine will known. But this says nothing, and the good possesses the strength to wound evil creatures, hell. Feeling themselves wounded, they are armed against the good and would like to annihilate the good, she or he who wants to make the good known. But in spite of all that which they wanted at the first beginning, on his wanting the knowledge of my divine will to be born, and that he wants it to reign, they have suffocated him. Yet he has made the first steps, and that which some didn't believe, others have believed. The first steps will call the second, the third, and so on. In spite that there won't lack those people who arouse contradictions and doubts, but it is of absolute necessity that one knows my divine will and that I can give him and want to give him. These are the conditions that without them, God cannot give that which he wants to give. The creatures cannot receive him. Therefore, pray and do not give back. Do not give back in making my divine will known. The time, the circumstances, the things, the persons change. They are not always those. Therefore, that which one doesn't obtain today can be obtained tomorrow. However, to the confusion of who has suffocated a good so great, but my will triumph and will have his kingdom upon the earth.
Can we stop there just a minute? Open for any thoughts or just kind of take this.
Well, it's just what's happening, right? I mean, he says in the writings that it's just like when he came on the earth, it's not for free, right? This great good is not going to be for free, just like his redemption wasn't for free. So it's following the same pattern, and that's what he's outlining. So it just is logical.
Set,
yeah,
not to judge,
right?
Actually not even to converse with those who are denying it. Have the strength to walk away.
Mm-hmm.
He says they might not know it today, but they'll everybody will live in God's will, he tells us. So why am I going to sit and argue with you today? And you might not be disposed. You got to go through the first part of this reading, because I know we're going to focus on this because this is all about what we're dealing with. But go back to the first part, that you have to be disposed to be able to want it, to know that God can give it, and that God will give it. And if you're not disposed, what am I going to sit there and argue with?
Yeah.
It's interesting, if you go back, just little things that he throws in here, not little things, but he says, my celestial mother and Saint Joseph. So, you know, it's not just Mary or just my mother, it's my celestial mother. So just 2,000 years of Catholicism arguing with forever. It's happened from the moment that he was incarnated. We've had there's been an argument, lack of disposition on all levels of Christianity. Even now, the God is making known his divine will. So when he came upon the earth, he gave us the knowledge of the Trinity, and now he returns to give us the knowledge of the divinity. But we know that every knee will bend and every tongue will confess.
Yeah.
So go back and remember the first part about they're not disposed. And if you look at him as a creature of God, I'm not going to argue with you.
Right.
You know, you want to, right? Because you love it.
Yeah.
But you got to love it enough to not argue, to not disperse this to souls who are not disposed, because you can do more damage to them than you can good.
Yeah.
And people forget that. Walk away. I would never entertain a conversation with anybody who wants to get that nasty about the divine will, the Blessed Mother, the Pope, the Catholic Church, you name it. We have Christian, I think that's what Christianity is all about. Martyrdom. It's like Christian martyrs. I mean, the two go together. Maybe not a red martyrdom, but a white martyrdom. White martyrdom. And sometimes that white martyrdom is just to say, may God bless you and walk away. go ahead.
No, I didn't mean to.
Oh, no. Because they're not disposed.
That was yesterday's gospel about Nazareth, where Jesus returned and he was rejected by his own people.
Yeah.
And you're right, he took it and he was quiet. He didn't bother to fight or to rebuke or to show his sadness.
Yeah.
I mean, his own people.
It's funny because I finished volume 36. I was telling Angela, I I knew I was going to finish it the first or the second, but I chose to do it, finished. I knew the last writing. So I was like, I'm going to use the last writing last night, first Friday. And so I'm back at volume one, started volume one this morning. And you go back through and it just the, is I'm going to say the elementary of it, the academic of it, of who you need to just realize it's just you and me. Period. And that simplicity of stop. I know where they're at. I'm their God. I know their soul. And if you just go back to the simplicity of it's just you and me, it's the cog. You, me, Jesus, Luis, and the Blessed Mother. You won't, it's not that you're not going to run into the arguments, but you will not respond. In your beginning part, yesterday was the feast day of Alphonsus Liguori. He wrote the great on virtues. He wrote the great, I don't know what you call it, he became a doctor of the church on being virtuous. And it was Thomas Aquinas who said, you have to become, virtue has to become your nature. And this is part of being virtuous, to the highest level virtuous, meaning that you're bilocating and generating divine lives are the two highest levels of virtues you can be. And of course, you're not thinking about it, right? Because it was just you and God, of course, you're being virtuous. And walk away is to be virtuous versus thinking you need to be prudent or whatever. You just, why? It does that person and yourself so much harm to sit there and argue. Or even if you don't consider it arguing, stop discussing it.
Right.
If they didn't pick up with the words divine will, leave.
And it's not a, it's not a, like a, I'm stiff-arming you as a person kind of believing. It's just a, it, there's, we've all gone through some form of transformation in how we are living. And one of the things we need to recognize with this, I think, is that we're, the mission that we have as the early, you know, he talks about the early stages of making it known and just being at the beginning of this is, you know, our mission is at this stage is to repair, reorder, redo, and generate divine acts so that God can start receiving these acts back to him as he was intended. And so that to me, it doesn't mean that I need to spend my time on converting someone
as no.
because they will come to know this in however form they might come to know it. And that disposition is going to come. And as we know, if they're disposed, then they will move further and further into this. If they're not, you know, they're either going to just say, just take it as a, I'm, you know, that's not anything I'm interested in. There's others that are a lot more vehement about this that we know that are out there. They're trying to put it down. But it's important with the me and you context of I'm doing my mission for you, which is what you want me to do, which is to come to understand and gain these knowledges and understand what the love and how I'm wanting you to operate, because when you do, there's all this beauty that comes from it. But it's not to go out and to, you know, stand on the side of the street.
It's not to go out anywhere.
Near prior, if you will.
And this is the problem. Yeah. People read this sentence, therefore pray and do not fall behind in making my divine will known. And therefore, all of a sudden, people, I just heard from Father Bart last week, and then he walked into his bishop's office and someone on his desk is all 36 volumes of Luisa Picaretta. Someone bought him and sent him to the bishop. And he looked at Father Bart. It's too funny. Have you ever heard of this? It's like, I know it very well. But Father Bart said, this is why people think that people living the divine will are crazy. What are you doing? Why are you just sending 36 volumes off to somebody? It's because they're not understanding this sentence. Pray and do not fall behind in making my divine will known. It's not you.
Turn it inside.
Divine will known. It is your acts generating divine lives that are entering into souls as you bilocate. And they might not be disposed today, as he said, but they will be disposed. It is not a one-on-one conversation. It is literally doing all your acts one-on-one with the Lord that generates the divine lives. Never, ever, ever has this happened to those born of common stock. And if you think sending a bishop 36 volumes is going to get him to convert and then be preaching about it and then the whole diocese, that is not in these writings anywhere.
Mary, sorry, Mary, I didn't mean to interrupt you, but I just came out of my Divine Will group and put you on as I was shopping through Wegmans, and everything that you guys are talking about is exactly what we just were questioning and finding out for ourselves in our group, and you just, your group just confirmed everything that we just learned.
Good.
I'm just so amazed I could cry.
It's the Holy Spirit.
I really could. Yes. It's just so mind-blowing how God does that. And we were just saying, like, how are we supposed to share this with other people? Are we supposed to share it with other people? And you just confirmed everything that we talked about. I just can't thank you guys enough for being advanced in this and help someone like me who's only so far in it. So I thank you all.
You're welcome.
And Paul, I see your hands raised. Give me 1 second here. Pick your intro and as an opportunity, you know, if you want to think about, all right, how do I do this?
Or if you're supposed to do it.
Yeah.
Why do we think that every conversation is supposed to be leading someone to the divine will?
Exactly.
It's just what Kelly had said. You've got to rely on the Holy Spirit. Yeah. You just prayed it. Do you not think that the Holy Spirit's going to give you the words? He says, do not worry about the words to say, I will provide the words for you. And we all come in with our written speech. Well, this is what I want to say to this person. It's going to convert them. And oh my gosh, we're going to talk to my will for the rest of our lives. I've been having dinner every Thursday night with a priest since before Pentecost. And I have not one time mentioned the divine will, except for last Thursday. And I just said divine will. He asked me where I was going on my retreat. And I just said, it's a divine will retreat. That was it. Because I knew the Holy Spirit said, no, he's not disposed. Yeah. And his friendship means a lot to me right now. Do you understand what he just said? The divine will is everything to me. But I also know that this friendship is part of given to me by my Lord. And it too has significant meaning. Why would I blast it away by ruining it, by hurting him?
And it's simple. It's a focus on what our mission is, what he tells us our mission is. And then there will be a moment when someone says something and you'll say divine will, and they will go, okay, and that's that. Or they'll say, what does that mean? And you'll say a little bit more, and then they'll, and it may be a conversation, it may not, but don't, we don't want to be like pouncers.
Like, you didn't do it. You didn't do it. Do this. Do that. No.
It'll happen. Those things will happen.
I started letter corresponding with a man in prison 12 years ago. I found him online. Anyways, he was part of this blog of Our Lady of Good Success. And so he was looking for anybody who would want to write to him when he was in prison. So I've been corresponding to him. It is 2024. I just sent him the Book of Heaven because all I had to say to him is the kingdom's coming. And when he wrote back, he said, please tell me, what do you mean the kingdom's coming? I said, well, how many books can you have? But I just sent him, you know, and let me tell you guys, you can't just send a prisoner a book. It has to be have a receipt on it. It has to come from the publisher, because prisoners know how to, I guess, douse the pages in drugs. And they were sending him books and the pages would be in drugs and the prisoners read the pages. Too much information.
Yeah.
This book, the Book of Heaven, went right to him. It wasn't stopped. It wasn't halted. Nothing. He said it has never happened. It was just delivered. Anyways, but he was disposed.
He was disposed to whatever level. That's how you walk through this. It's not an assault on every single person. Because what we want to do is we feel so strongly about it we all go through this phase of I want to tell as many people as I can, but that's not the right way to go for it. It's a matter of it's maintaining your peace and not being disturbed in a positive way as yeah. well. And but yet taking the opportunities when they arrive, but you don't have to like it's not jumping out. Sorry, Paula, go ahead. Your hand's been out for a while. So
yeah, I have maybe two topics, but let's to the last. Of course, the basis is to dispose people by doing our acts in the divine will and study it. This is a way we help people to be disposed, of course. And then there is also this that we can, you know, if Jesus is operating in us, he will arrange situation. And we just have to say one word like the kingdom, Mary said, is coming on somebody. What? And is interested. If not, you know, no problem. Right. Don't missionizing people, of course. But it's both. You know, we also will spread the knowledge by discussing it, and some God will lead this, how people come together. But it's not us.
Right.
It's God himself. What we are doing really is important, that we are living in the divine will, so that the knowledge is going out to the whole world. You know, by our receiving, we are also a source for the knowledge to spread. And first finish this topic, but then I really like to talk a little bit more about not the question is somewhat disposed or not, so now what means disposing? You know, in the beginning of this reading, with the soul is disposing herself.
Yes,
it's not just you are disposed, finished or not, but there is a soul is disposing herself, and she is disposing God. You know, there are two fiats necessary. And this is this asking for. I would like to talk about this, but maybe we finish this first topic first.
Oh, finish this reading? Do we not finish it?
No.
Yeah, no, we still have a little bit more.
No, but
it's in
all right, go ahead. Judy or either one.
So what I'd like to highlight, I don't know. So it was said earlier, it's not free. It isn't free, but the gift is free. It's a gift. The sense in which it's not free is that you do need to be disposed, and you may need to do some work to do that. You do have to prove that you really want it. And I don't know if this, has to do with what Paula wants to talk about, but it seems like it might. But I really do want to underscore when Mel stopped and he said, we hear, you know, you've seen all these online cynicals and people say, all you have to do is ask for it. I actually thought he was going to qualify that, because I think it really needs a qualification, and this reading says it. Ask for it with incessant prayers, because as they pray, so we I can't read it on my little thing, but it could be that you ask and you receive it immediately, and I kind of think that actually I think you do it. For one who must live in the divine will, you are going to get that gift, and you may not realize it, but he starts working with you and he shows you what that means. But he wants you to ask with incessant prayer. You have to know the value of it. You have to understand it, and it can't be something that is just gonna be wasted, the $1 million bill just torn up, played with, and thrown away.
So let's finish reading this, Judy, and then, yeah, let's talk about it, because I was going to talk about that as well, and I think that's what Paula was going to get to, too. There's 4 degrees, and you ask, is the 4th degree? But there's 9 levels in the 4th degree that everybody forgets about. So if you just want to stand with your ankles in it and never have to go through anything, yeah, you're living in the divine will, but you're not fully in that 9th choir, should we say, that he just talks about. So yeah, you've gone through the marriage, but you can't, nobody who is married knows that you can't just go through the wedding ceremony and say, hey, that's it. I never have to say I love you again or do anything or suffer for you or do any sort of gratuitous acts or just to be or whatever. That's not how a marriage works. So you're correct. You can say I want to get married and say I do, but that doesn't make a marriage. That's just that day saying, I want this. And then you don't go the next day and say, hey, I got married to you. I'm done. I don't have to do anything else. No, it's a long thing. And you grow in it by the cross, the marriage of the cross. Remember, it's not that you just go through 4 marriages. Every one of those marriages is a marriage. Let me say that again. Every one of those marriages is a marriage in and of its own.
Which means to something.
So yes, in order, he tells us in these writings, to grow further into the kingdom, you must suffer, which is the marriage of the cross. And so if you want to gain a new knowledge, he says, you'll have to go through the cross to get the knowledge, which leads you into the marriage of the Trinity, which in and itself isn't just our marriage of the Trinity and all is done. And that's what you're saying. Yes, you can say, I desire it, and it happens, but there's still work to be done. And that's what this whole thing that Mel has put out for us for the next few weeks is that you do have to participate to his, you have to cooperate to his operating. It's a marriage. And by the way, those of us who are married, and even those who are single and married themselves to their spouse, it's work.
You know, may I say something that, you know, in the Jewish marriage, you have this betrothal phase, you know, it's very important. Jesus is saying here, this asking for it, he said, little love letters. Little not love only letter. One, little love letters. And this... for disposing the soul, because God can give this gift only if there is, you know, a space. The space is prepared. This is the betrothal state. It's already marriage, maybe you can say, yeah. But the space has to be prepared. He says, within her, she forms within herself the royal palace. Mm-hmm. So there is a place. It's when we go to Holy Communion, we have also to prepare ourselves that we can receive it. Then he said, she acquires the love in order to love it. That's necessary, you know. And she acquires the qualities of sacrifice to hold the mm-hmm. gift. So we have to grow. There must be space. We have to grow in love, and we have to grow in sacrifice for holding this gift. In a certain sense, this is a preparation, a betrothal. If it's already, you know, clear, we are sure that he will give it to you, but there is a phase where you have of a preparation. And then the consummation can happen, you know. God that always prepares. He prepared our lady so he could come. God is always preparing the space where he had wants to give his gift. So it's a phase. It's a little time. It needs preparation. And when you are married, when the consummation takes place, of course, then we dive deeper and deeper. And I understand it's necessary to ask for it. You know, God said the church had to pray to our Father for a long time. This is the preparation. you know, again and again, thy kingdom come, please. So there is a preparation state, and then the consummation can happen. And during the preparation state, the soul and God are disposing. You know, I write this love letters, and then I receive the love letter of God, and he says, yes, I will marry you. It's not, there is a phase of this, you know, oh God, God knows if we are disposed or not. But nevertheless, we have to go through a phase where we are prepared. When I started to read, I had in the beginning, I had always this question, I am disposed. Oh, I hope so much that I am disposed, you know. I hope so much, but I don't know if I am disposed or not disposed. And this question disappeared one day. And my reading and my longing for it disposed it. And I remember that Father John Olin Brown said one day, if you receive the gift, you know, fourth degree, often, I don't think it's always, often this is somehow confirmed by heaven, so you know, with some supernatural something happening. It's not necessary, I think, but he said something very, it's often. So that the soul really knows that she received the gift. Maybe she is, you know, I had really these questions, and now I don't have these questions anymore. And after, so you have to go on with this little love letters. Oh, please. Oh, I'm longing so much for it. I'm studying. I'm longing so much for this gift. But this has to be continuously. Yes. And I was thinking, if you are sure that you received the gift, you are sure of all the knowledge, you know, and of your life journey, you still have to go on to long for the gift. Also, you already have it, because, you know, this longing is, oh, not give me the gift, but let me dive deep in it, you know, as deep as possible. So this longing for the gift never stops. Also, you already have the gift. It's then, you know, what you got just talked about, the nine choirs of the children of the divine will. So that's the longing never stops. It's a continuously act. And so, I see this stages before the fourth degree as this betrothal stage. God knows if we are... will go this way. But for us, we have really disposed ourselves, and we have to receive the confirmation from God, because there are two fiats. God must be disposed to give it to us. He wants to give it to us, but it doesn't, as Judy said, he will not give this gift to, as I said, childish souls. Souls are that not really serious. So we have to go through a process of disposing ourselves and God that this marriage really is.
Yeah. You know, Father Brown would use the analogy a lot of, he's going to hand you the gift. You want it, he'll hand you the gift, but he holds on to it. And that whole disposal that you've just kind of described, that as we're going deeper and further in understanding, it's a, you know, then he lets go of it when he's confident in you as you are trying to be confident in him. Haynes, I see your hands back down. Do you? I think that Josephine.
I think Paula just summed up what I was going to say too. Longing for the divine will disposes you more to receive more. That was a beautiful statement. And also, love requires love. So, and you do, you fall more deeply in love with the divine will as you are exploring the writings. And the writings never are the same, as we all can attest to. Each time you read it, it's just another peeling away of the onion layers or the layers of the rose, I should say, rather than an onion. And Jesus is operating in us. So we don't have to worry about other souls. They're going to get here when they get there, and they'll get there by even just standing next to somebody at line in a supermarket. You know, it's not even a word. Really? It is supernatural. And in this particular writing, he even says, he goes, these are the conditions without which God cannot give what he wants to give, and the creature cannot receive it. Because we got here, all of us, by our love of the Lord. Mm-hmm. And I'm not saying other people don't love the Lord. I'm just saying we had, each one of us, surrendered to something a long time ago to get where we are today. And it's not, it's never ending. And we are going to suffer, because this is, I mean, Louisa suffered. She lived in a bed for her entire life. And God wants us to come to love him freely. Who wants to hit somebody over the head and say, you're my prisoner now, and I'm going to make you love me? You know, he's sincere.
He doesn't do that.
Yeah, no, he's not that guy, you know.
He wants to hit us over the head for other reasons, but not to make
you. Yeah. But you all be careful, because just hear me out. Be careful, because I don't want anybody to go self-reflecting and like, did I experience any sort of mystical experience of knowing that I received the gift? Do you desire it? Go back to the four. If you desire it, you're getting it, because God is eternal, God is infinite, and God is perfect. He doesn't work on our timeline. He works on his timeline. So if you've been disposed and you've picked up the book of heaven and you feel it within you, you're desiring it. And now you go home, you're like, I just listened to the cynical, nothing mystical ever happened to me. I'm not in the fourth degree. I'll never get there. Blah, 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 blah. Don't do that.
Yeah.
Do not do that. You need to say, hey, I got the gift. That's it. Yes. To literally have to say, I believe, I receive. I believe, I receive. I'm going to continue on in this. Because there's so many times we enter into cynicals and you'll hear people say, I'm not in the fourth degree. First of all, that doesn't even need to be stated at all to anybody, because it means that you're self-reflecting and causing others to self-reflect. And the fourth degree is the divine will. If you're reading and attending cycles, you're there. Just keep going. What we're saying is that you're never done. You're always going to desire. Every day I still pray and on my knees, even though I've experienced something mystically, I still, you know, want it. I don't want to, you know, I still want it. I still ask for it. I still want to know more. And this is me. So I read everything I possibly can. And yesterday I almost got like reprimanded, because I went into Ignatius. His feast day was the other day. And a priest was like, what are you doing? Put Ignatius down. I'm like, yeah. You're right. I didn't read it. I was like, I bought it, fumbled through it. I'm like, man, this is a lot of self-reflection. And it took a vocal word from a priest saying, put it down. Because we can let human thoughts still enter into us.
Yeah.
We got to remember, I believe, I receive. I receive and I believe. The two. So.
And just so you're right. Going to get back to you. One more thing.
You're right. You know, it. I don't want to bring this stress to people. You are right. But and Father John Braun Dutton said it's must. He said just he watched that often.
Mm-hmm.
Often. It is not a must, you know, not. So it's like, but you have to continuously longing for it, believing it, you know. That's the point.
Yeah, and
I believe, I receive. I believe, I receive. That has to be continuously.
Mm-hmm.
I even hesitated putting the writing on the four degrees in here.
Because I saw it, I cringe.
Because I want to make it, because and here's why we cringe. And I'm going to reiterate what Mary said. This is not about putting a thermometer up on a sign on the side of your house or in your kitchen or wherever, and where's that red mark? Where's it taking me? This has nothing to do with that. And the only, in my mind, the point of the 4 degrees, A, it's to make a bit of some distinction, but it's about growth. It is about that learning and continuing to move further out and deeper down. And we'll talk through that here in about 3 or 4 more readings. But if we're trying to keep an assessment of where we are, you're looking at it completely wrong. You've got to throw that away, and you can't even worry about it. It's just information that he is providing to us on how things look. He does a lot of that, right? He talks about how it looks about this. And when he uses an example, you can visualize it looks like that. It's about looking. It's not about where am I? And guess what? I made it.
You know what?
It's just not there.
When Mel was just speaking, I'm going to draw you back. All of you have read this reading, and there's a reading where our Louisa is feeling oppressed because she's reading about the Blessed Mother, and the oppression comes upon her because she, of course, born of common stock, was not immaculately conceived, and therefore feels like she'll never be able to love God on the level of our Blessed Mother. That is a true thing that you will go through. And I want to use the word oppressed, not jealousy and not envy. But your desire, when we say desire, that's a desire. To get to that point where you look at the Blessed Mother and you just, I want to love you. I want to feel that love that our Blessed Mother had for our Lord. She was immaculately conceived. She didn't even.
You got to see Jordan. Yes.
Hold on. She didn't even commit the smallest venial sin. I'm not saying that you all haven't gone through this. This is what Paula is saying is about your desire. Your desire grows. And when you get to levels where you're looking at the Blessed Mother and you just, I don't want to just say I love you with all the love of our Blessed Mother. I want to know I can love you on the level of our Blessed Mother. I want to know that, and she loves greater than every single soul put together. That's the virtue of bilocation. Bilocation is not just, I'm entering into all souls and bring you all love. Bilocation is exactly what Paula went through the last 8 weeks on heart and heartbeat. Desire isn't just, I desire to live in the divine will because I know I'm safe. Desire is, I want to feel that heartbeat. I want to feel the breath. I want to love the way our Blessed Mother loved. I want this. That's desire. Does that desire stop because you've given your fiat? Your fiat just allows your desire to grow. Disposition allows you to give your fiat. So even though you might have a mystical experience that you're in the fourth degree, the suffering of the marriage of the cross is the suffering of our Blessed Mother at the foot of the cross, right? It's the love of St. John. It's the love of being Jesus on the cross and looking at every single soul, his last glance before he said, into your hands I commend my spirit. You grow into that love, that desire. That's all I want to, you know, just, I will never tell you that you're not in the fourth degree, but the fourth degree is not the end all. It's not like, oh, we won the race. No, you're just at the starting line to get to something that is incredible, to where you want to love so much, you're bawling your eyes out that you want to love the way that they love. And unfortunately, we're using the word love, which is such an English word that I can't even describe it except for the limited way I would just try to do it. You know, you just sit there and think of our Blessed Mother and to be able to love as she loved, immaculately conceived. And that's the gift, because you are a newborn, immaculately conceived. He has washed your seed to live in his most holy divine will. You understand what I'm saying? Like, it is the greatest gift. No, you cannot merit it, but it's not one and done. And a lot of people are not disposed to want to go that far into something. It's not even reading the 36 volumes, which is in and itself, but the thought of being able to go into that deep of a love relationship, they've never experienced it and have no idea. That's disposition.
Thank you.
What else?
Josephine, you had one question.
Yes, everything actually is great and covered, but I had this thought in it, you know, when I heard the sharing about finding something and confirmed here, and it's related to previous discussions we had about knowledge, that it's one thing to have knowledge from an earthly, you know, point of view, just by our own skills, and but it's another to have knowledge through experience, because God's, and that's what I heard here earlier, because God's riches are, we cannot, you know, it's too profound, and his ways and methods cannot be accessed unless, this is what I believe, unless we have the mind and heart of Christ. And Mel, you mentioned this, that it wasn't only the fact that they know about it and we shared our knowledge, but the important thing, the trigger in that person who said, oh, everything we were arguing about, I heard from you, is the trigger was her experience that, oh, wow, I just found this book. We just read this and I actually heard, it's like, it's actually hearing Christ. It's actually feeling the love of Christ. So it's not only knowing about Christ now, but it's actually seeing, hearing, and being with Christ. That's what I wanted to share.
Thank you. Thank you. Okay, then why don't we get back to the reading? I think we still have a little bit to do. And interesting, the palace, we're going to talk about the palace here in just a little bit too.
Okay. Whence I continue to think of the divine will, and I abandoned all of myself in his divine arms, and my beloved Jesus added, good daughter, you should know that my divine will possesses and contains inside of himself everything, all the joys, all the beauties. From him everything goes forth, and without losing anything, he contains everything within himself. It can be said that he carries everyone and everything in his immense womb of light, so that everyone lives in him, with this difference, that one who with all her will wants to live in him and lets herself be subjugated by his dominion lives as daughter. And as daughter becomes constituted heiress of joys, of beauties, of the goods of her mother, the divine will, in a way that this divine mother is all intent to embellish, to enrich, and to make her daughter rejoice. Instead, one who wants to live of the human will and does not let herself be subjugated by the dominion, she lives in the holy will, but lives not as daughter, but as stranger. And all the joys are converted for the creature into bitterness, the riches into poverty, beauties into ugliness, because living as stranger, she lives as set apart from the goods that my divine will possesses, and justly merits that she possesses nothing of the good. Her human volition that subjugates her gives her that which it holds, passions, weaknesses, miseries. Nothing escapes from my divine will, not even hell. And since they have not loved him in life, they have lived as limbs detached from him, but always inside, not outside. Now, in these dismal prisons, joys, happinesses, the beatitudes of my divine will are converted into sufferings and into internal torments. Therefore, the living in my will is not new, as some believe. Everyone lives in him, good and bad. If one wants to say new, it is the way of living. one who recognizes him as continuous acts of life, who gives him the dominion in all her acts, because the living in him is the sanctity of every instant that the creature receives. It can be said that as she grows continually in sanctity, but sanctity fed by my will grown together with him, so that she fills my will for life more than her own life. But instead, one who doesn't live in him, in spite that she remains there within, she doesn't recognize him in her every act, and lives as if she might live distant from him and might not receive the continuous act of his life, in spite that she receives it. In this way, the sanctity of living my volition is not formed, but at the most, sanctity of circumstances, so that they remember my divine will when oppressed by a need, a sorrow, a cross. Then he hears them exclaim, the divine will be done. And in all the rest of their life, my will, where is he? Were you going to say something?
When you get to the end of the paragraph.
Okay. Instead, isn't he already with them, contributing to all their acts? He remained, but they didn't recognize him. It happens as to a mother that lives in her palace, who has given forth many children into the light. Some of these always remain around the mother, whom infuses in the children her noble ways. She feeds them with delicate and good food, dresses them with decent attire, entrusts her secrets to them, and makes them heirs of her goods. One can say that the mother lives in the children and the children in the mother. They felicitate each other in love with inseparable love. The other children live in the palace of the mother, but are not always around her. They find pleasure in living in the distant rooms from those of the mother. Hence, they don't learn her noble ways. They don't dress with decency. The goods they take do them more evil than good. And if sometimes they go to the mother, it is not for love, but for need. Whence the great difference between the one and the other of these children. In spite of all this, the one and the other live in the palace of the mother. Thus, everyone lives in my will, but only one who wants to lives of him, lives in him, lives as child with her mother. All the others, in spite that they live in him, they don't even know him. Others live as strangers. Others know him in order to offend him.
Thanks for reading that. Enjoy it.
I would like to do it.
Don't hesitate.
Add this reading. This cynical read it in 2020. And probably we've read it a couple of other times as well. I think it's important to remember that this cynical is for us that are wanting the basics of how we should run in our journey, walk in our journey. And what I love is that no matter how often we read a particular knowledge, we are still able to go, wow, this is the most beautiful reading, the most beautiful knowledge. But I really am in awe each time, because we always go back to the basics. We always go back to what our mission is. We all, no matter, you know, how long we've been doing this or how new we are, the cynical is about just reading and learning our knowledges from the basics. And what I wanted to add is that every day, even no matter, I don't remember how long, I think 2017 might have been the first time I came to this home. And from the moment I was at the first meeting, I guess I was disposed. I've never got out of my walk or my journey or wherever it is that I'm to be. But every day when I read my prevenient act that Lemess gave me, or, you know, coming to my to Our Lady's lap, George, one meeting, raised up this little pamphlet that Tony Hickey put together some years ago. And I, when you did that, you know, it was earlier times that you were here, it's like you were just starting to walk. And I thought, I have that, I'm going to go back. So every morning since, I just read the purpose of the gift of the divine will. Even though my walk has been a few years, I still need the basics to remind me, to ground me, to guide me. The purpose of the gift of the divine will is to allow God to receive perfect, perfect glory from the whole family. And perfect reparation is the primary work of the gift. How basic can that get? It's important for me to remind myself exactly where I'm going and what I'm doing and what my mission is. But it's knowledges like this that embellish, you know, even more and reinforces, you know, what I'm doing. I don't try to figure out what stage I am, or, you know, if I fall a little and I say, you know what, just prepare me, you know, for whatever suffering you have for me, or whatever joy. Cynicals are vital to our walk.
Mm-hmm. If you go back to Father Brown at the initiation of this cynical, and if you happen to have access to some old materials, there was a long phrase in there about the applied sciences of the divine will. And the point of that, in a little bit fewer words, was, as we've talked about a variety of times on our cynicals, is to take these knowledges that are in the Book of Heaven, talk about them, discuss them, in a way that we can tangibly take that knowledge and incorporate it into us. And so there's two phases of that, right? The first phase is, as you say, the going back to the basics. And we do talk about the basics quite a bit. But the reason that we do that, in my mind, is when you talk about the basics, it continues to shore up that foundation of knowledges that you don't, as we've talked earlier, and then Mary even mentioned it about, you know, how many times do we go back and say, am I in, am I not in, mm-hmm. am I disposed? The reason for being somewhat, I'll say, repetitive on some of these, quote, basic readings and writings is to be able to constantly be hearing that and bring it into the point to where we don't go back and think about that anymore. And what does that do? I'll use the word dispose, further dispose again, because we're always being disposed. It allows us then to go through a 13-week session like Heart and Heartbeat with the foundation of what Jesus is talking about, to the point that we look at those writings that Paula put together and that we all talk through, and we're able to get deeper into meaning on those. So that's, I think, and That's a good way to put it, but that's kind of why we do some of the things that we do, and it's all geared towards being able to kind of get into that cycle of the more you read, the more you want, the more you read, and how you understand that, and it comes into becoming part of us, that's how we go deeper, that's how we get further, that's how we the love that we're trying to achieve to be able to replicate as Mary did. That's how we find that. So that's a point. I mean, from my standpoint, that's the way I see it, and how that with all of the different people that we have not only on the Zoom call, but around the table here is that we all are coming from a different perspective, and everybody's perspective helps us to keep getting higher and higher.
We all come from a different perspective, but
we all come from the same place, though.
But we all have been trained the same way, right? Because while Barb was showing the book and so forth, go back to sitting there and just think about the rosary and how simple it is to pray the rosary. But if you're just praying the rosary and just saying Hail Marys and the Our Father and not going into the meditative state, you're missing the gift of the rosary. And so that's what we're saying. Awesome. It's what our Lord is saying. Like for 2,000 years, you've been praying the Our Father. For 2,000 years, you've been praying the Our Father, and now I've given to you the fullness of the meaning of the prayer of the Our Father. You know, the Our Father prayer disposed us for 2,000 years to where God said, all right, the tree is formed. It's now time to return to teach them about the divine will, to teach them about my divinity. And so the rosary, and that's what we're all saying is, you know, the same thing. Just it's to break it down is, you know, you could pray all five mysteries of the rosary. You could pray all, you know, every, you know, all four of them. Or you could just pray one and it just take you the whole day that you're in that prayer. And an example of this is go back to volume one. I know it's simple because I just read it this morning. Mm-hmm. And how she could go into one of the excesses of love of the moment when the Trinity said, it is time to incarnate yourself in the Blessed Mother. And you know, to be in that moment with the Trinity. And just, she said, I could spend all day, she probably could spend all 9 months on it because the incredible of that moment. Yeah, you understand what I'm saying? Like, you could just read it, just like, I read it, but you disposition and your love grows so much that you're no longer just reading this anymore. And it used to be, right, you could stop in one paragraph and just be on that paragraph. Then it could be one sentence, or you could just now stop on one word. I mean, the word celestial before his mother just took me to a whole different place, you know. It happened also when we were praying the Holy Spirit prayer. And just what are you asking the Holy Spirit to do with the light, to give you the knowledge? It's what you're asking in that prayer. And all through this, she talks about the light. You know, I was infused with the light. The light entered into my thinking, whatever. It's nice to go back to the beginning. Go back to your little book. Mm-hmm. And go back to this little book. But you're so far now you're so disposed now into your palace that you're not just opening the door and walking into the palace. You're now into a room of the palace and you're sitting on the furniture and you're looking at the decorations and you're experiencing, and you might look at one decoration, be a word, and you can't leave that room because you're focused on that one word, and the Lord is going to take you, draw you into someplace. That's not just disposition. That's living it. Do you know what I'm saying? Like, that's what we're saying when you keep reading these writings over and over again, or a simple prayer or whatever. And the reason is because it is the word of God and he's alive. And every word is him. So I always tell people, if you're new and starting to read the writings, you never read them fast. And you have to pay attention to the verb that's being used, or the noun, or the adjective, because God didn't just throw those words in there, because he is the word. So look at the verb text. Meaning, is it a past? Is it a present? Is it a future? Is it an active verb? Is it, look at the way that this is written. And don't be concerned on, you know, she read from a different translation that we read, but it was the exact same reading. The verbs never changed. The verb text never changed. The adjectives never changed. The words were just in different order. Does that make sense?
Yes.
It's the word, you know what? I don't understand this as this part of a sentence. It can be. A word of God is sometimes a single grammatical word, like terrestrial, yeah. Or it's a little sentence, you know. Yep. A word of God, you know. If people pray, the free churches, you know, this, they are asking for a word of God, and that can be 2-3 sentences.
Mm-hmm.
I don't understand word like this part of a grammatical structure. But it can be one word, you know, Father. But it's not necessary. It's not. You know, it is not, you know, if you translate the hour of passions in different languages, and you can make different translations, some with more words, some with less words, you know, some languages, you can say it shorter. It's not on this level, but it can be a single grammatical word. But there, I think this is a misunderstanding to say, you know, his end and article and, you know, each word. That's not the sin. A word of God is always something living with something. Mm-hmm. It's a truth, always a truth.
Mm-hmm.
I think it's a misunderstanding to say it. It's each single word. How, and sometimes, you know, there are languages you need more words to express the same thing. In other language, it's different. So it doesn't depend on the translation. It's only this. A word of God is something else. Yeah.
No, you're right. It doesn't matter on the translation, because a lot of people are waiting for the critical edition. That's not what this is dependent upon. It is exactly, and how it is translating your, like I said, she has a different version than what we have, but read what it is saying. And it's the intention of it. And so that's why he's saying, so in our language, if it's, you know, the verb text or whatever, it's the intention of that sentence that you're reading. You're right. It's not, it's not the, what am I trying to say?
Context.
Is that it?
You know, I think what we're saying is, depending on the language, the intention can be, maybe it's 3 words in that language, and it may be 8 right. in this, but it's the intentions.
And to it, even further, Paula, what I was leading to is, there will come to a time where you are, and you're there. Well, that didn't make sense, Mary. What are you trying to say? Trying to articulate this. Luisa will say, I can't even write it into human words what I just saw. Mm-hmm. I think that's what I'm trying to say, is like, take your time with this. Mm-hmm. Because you learn further on in the readings, and I think it's volume 36, because I just finished it, where our Lord and you will just, you don't even have to speak words, and you know exactly where he's leading you and showing you and telling you.
Absolutely.
Because he is the word. And to your point, Paula, the Hebrew language, one word is a whole paragraph of meaning. So, yeah, I mean, that's what I'm, like, the rosary is not just Hail Mary's not Father, it's the meditation that's important to it. So also with these, it's not about the words as much as it is the intent, the meditation that you go into. Don't just read palace without entering into the palace, without using your mind, your intellect, your imagination to see what that palace looks like, to see what the Mother Divine Will wants to show you within that palace. Love that palace. that's yours. It's your kingdom. You know, don't just read it just to read, but you are supposed to meditate, contemplate, and go into that the deepest level of silence in these writings so that God can show you the celestial realm of what he's telling you about in these writings. If you're not disposed, you're not going to get there. And that's what he's saying about this gift. That takes a disposition. And if you're not contemplative or a soul is not contemplative, they're not going to be able to understand these. Also, these writings are extremely theological. We're talking St. Augustine. We're St. Thomas Aquinas. We're talking Justin. We're talking deep theology in this. And not everybody understands that deep theology. You're reading things about generating divine lives. You're reading things about bilocating. And when you say bilocating to souls, they go right to Padre Pio and think of it as ad extra bilocation versus ad internal bilocation. That's what we're trying to say. These writings, almost like the people who are trying to force this down other people's throats, dare to say, they need to stop and read. Because you're not understanding the
internal nature of this.
I mean, we read one reading and we're still not done really discussing what was thoroughly in this. And that's what God is saying, is that read each word. Palace is not just a, you know, go into the palace, go into the quiet room, go into that place, be there with the Trinity. Be there with the Blessed Mother. Anyways.
And there's...
I remember a reading there. Jesus is talking that at each truth, it's a door. You know, if you meditate, it's a door. And there is an angel. An angel who helps you to go through this door.
Yeah.
And understand, getting back to the point you were making about take it slow and pay. If the point is, don't try to read for the sake of reading. Read for the sake of understanding. And that doesn't mean that you'll always understand everything, but as you're taking it in a contemplative manner, then you'll pick up on different things. And there's this last reading as an example, you know, it was split in two, basically. The first half was, the three things that we always talk about, if you want this to operate in this will, all you have to do is ask for it, believe that they want to give it, and believe that they can give it, they being the Trinity. And that's a point of disposition where you're now to a point, if that's where you are, then you'll take these writings and you'll want to eat them all up and try to understand them. But in the second half, when he's talking about the palace, all through the Bible, there's the differences that are discussed between heirs/sons and daughters and the servants. And he makes that distinction in the second part about everybody's living in the divine will. The divine will is in everyone because it is life. I mean, I think the second one, the third writing, he talks about the divine will is the life of everything. But so that's what presses us forward in our life. But how we operate and how we deal with that life, we're dealing it either as a servant or as an heir. We have that distinction. So there's a lot in these, to your point, there's a lot in these writings that you don't always pick them up with everyone, which is why many of them we do repeat, but it is not a, let me see how fast I can get through these books so I can say I've read 36 volumes.
Right.
It is a, I'm not going to try to understand every word as I read through them, but I am going to try to understand everything, and then I will come back. And he'll tell me at some point, he's going to tell me something I don't understand, and it's going to click in my brain, and I'm going to go, now I get that, and I remember reading it this way, and I remember reading it that way, and that's how it all folds together.
until you read it the next time.
Yeah, and then there'll be more knowledge the next time you read it, because now you've got that knowledge inside of you. And that's this whole progression that everybody has been talking about earlier of it never stops. Mm-mm. This will never, ever end. You'll never, ever get there. You'll always be going towards there if you want to think of it in those terms, but you'll never get there because there's so much that he has to give to us.
Interesting in that writing, it's not really ever discussed, but every single soul resurrects. Even the souls in hell resurrect. They'll be resurrected in hell, but they're resurrected. We always think of the resurrection as the resurrection of our Lord at the end of time, the resurrection of the soul and the life of the world to come, but every soul resurrects. Doesn't mean that they're all resurrected into heaven. Just they'll resurrect into hell, and nothing is separated from him. Even hell is in
course. Because he says that.
Yeah.
He said that earlier that the divine will has dominion over everything.
Yeah.
It may not in hell. It may remove itself from being there, but it still has dominion over.
Sure. And if they chose to resurrect in hell, then you chose to resurrect in hell. You chose to resurrect in heaven, you'll resurrect in heaven. So it's up to the soul to choose. Just as he's saying about the divine will, it'll come to a time where they will make a choice. What is happening now, from when they pulled the 36 volumes out of the vault in 1994, I'm sure that was 30 years ago that they took all 36 volumes and gave them to Pope John Paul II under the guide of Cardinal Ratzinger. 30 years we've had this. 16. So for 30 years, our Lord has been preaching the divine will, generating divine lives fully, because this was the time. You were calling down the kingdom. I want to say that your job is so important. You know, we're reading about people being disposed. Don't spend time on that. Do what you're supposed to do and call down the kingdom. That's your job. Call down the kingdom. And when all the acts have been done, repaired, and reordered for God, the dowry is complete. And then the bridegroom will come down and meet the bride. And at that time, everybody will be illuminated and ask, divine will, acts in light, or no, acts in darkness. Your choice, tells us this in the writings. So there will be those who live in the kingdom when it comes, who didn't do as we are doing and called it down. They weren't disposed at this time to do it. You were chosen to live during this time to call down the kingdom. There is nothing, nobody, whatever, so important. If you love your children, do this. You love your spouse, do this. Don't worry about your spouse living in the divine will or not. Do what you're supposed to do. This is the grace period where the children of light, that's who you are. Those who will live in the kingdom will be children. They'll have knowledge of this, but they'll be reading about what you did. They'll be reading about you call down the kingdom. That's this period that we're in. So I just reiterate, you have the most important job ever. Our Blessed Mother had the important job of calling down our King, the Redeemer, to incarnate him into her womb. You are to call down the Sanctifier, the Redeemer, and the Father to what? To incarnate themselves into you so that they can generate divine lives and that the kingdom can come for all souls. There will be souls who will live in the kingdom who rejected these writings. I'll say that again. There will be people who will live in the kingdom who rejected these writings, and they'll look at you like, oh my gosh, now I know. He says that in the writings. They will look at you and just be bewildered. I don't know if that's the word he used, but this is what you were talking about. This is the time We have been given a period to call down the kingdom and to repair, redo, reorder all acts.
And that's
it.
That's what we've been praying. That's what's been prayed for. Although we in our minds, we probably before had said, when are you going to do that, God? And God has said, I want you to do it.
Yeah. That's that reading.
I want you to do it. And here's how.
Yeah.
But I want you, you're going to be the ones to do it. You're going to be the ones to call me back down.
That's what he says when, so in the Genesis, and I know this isn't part of your discussion, but it is part of the discussion. In Genesis, after Adam had sinned, God the Father said, we need to basically close this up so he doesn't eat from the tree of life, or he will be living in his guilt the rest of eternity. So close it up. It's funny, Paula talks about the angel that leads you in there, because he puts an angel outside the Garden of Eden with the sword, and no one's been able to enter into that ever again until the kingdom was the divine will. That's what we've been waiting on, the divinity to come and reign. And it's happening, but we have to call it down. We have to, we are the ones that ends man's guilt. There will be no, we bind up Satan. There is no more sin, nothing. But we got to go through a lot of stuff. He says, I know their names and their numbers. So he knows. And he put you in front of somebody. You were put in front of George. Father Bart was put in front of you. You were put in front of Barbie. Obviously, I'm not put in front of anybody because I never bring anybody. That's all right. Just kidding.
That is.
What I'm saying is that he knows their names and numbers of who is going to be the child of light to call down the kingdom. Just do what you're supposed to do. And to what we've said before, if you start doubting this, you're not doing what you're supposed to be doing. Believe it to receive it. Do what you can. Keep growing further into it. And he does the operating. You cooperate with it by generating divine lives. You have become the nature of virtue. Virtue should be of nature, not of what he tells us in the first 10 volumes about the saints and like they want to be virtuous in patience or virtuous in obedience or virtuous in this. You become virtue itself. It's become your nature. You are by grace what they are by nature. That's the children of light. And if you're spending time on doubt, you are what? Dragging this along. So if everybody would just believe and do what they're supposed to do, the kingdom would come faster. Stop worrying. You've been given the greatest job ever for every single soul.
And so
there are still souls who will. He will decide, you know, that you will decide to live in the kingdom or not, the soul. Right. But there is also the possibility to live in the kingdom in heaven, like the saints. And there's this different, the children of redemption, who accepted that. So they will live in heaven like the saints. And some will live on earth. And they are different. They are belonging to children of light.
Yes.
So it's both. So we have three possibilities for the soul. The one who reject totally God, and then these two types of living in the kingdom.
Those who will live on earth and those who will live it in heaven.
Yeah,
and will live on earth as they do in heaven. Right.
Heaven is humanity.
And this is also very beautiful that, we are also helping people to choose, just to choose God and redemption.
Right.
Yeah, that's why you don't, you have no differential. You can't have any differential with people that we're running into and just having conversations with. And there is no differential between, there is, but there is not a differential between a child of light and a child of redemption. But the child of light has this mission that Mary has just talked about. There is a mission. We're here for a purpose. And others will be brought in at the time they're supposed to be brought in, as Mary mentioned. But the reiteration of our mission of repairing, redoing, generating acts is so fundamental to how he wants this to come to pass That's why Mary said earlier, you love your kids, stay on this mission. You love your spouse, stay on this mission. You want to do, you want to bring about the kingdom, call it down so his will is being done on earth as it is in heaven. Stay on this mission.
Yeah.
Because that's, you keep your eyes forward and the rest just happens. And the, and that's why you're distracted from the rest. And we talk about distraction a lot. You know what? The world's going to happen the way the world's going to happen, but we need to be focused on making these things come to pass with all our repairs and our learning and our deeper knowledges, because that's how the kingdom will ultimately come.
Earlier in the reading that we had read, he talked about even the temptation of Satan. What did he, I'd have to find it again, but to think about it. Don't ever doubt. He allows you to go through that doubting process so that you can chase away the doubt, right? You call down the kingdom. It's part of it. You call down the kingdom. You believe and you receive. When earlier Mel talked about, you know, God gives you the gift on loan. What? Don't even worry about that. If he's given to you on loan, your act is still a complete act, which I've said a couple of weeks ago. What does that mean, a complete act? It's a complete mass. Mass is the greatest prayer you can say. Well, now your act is the greatest thing. It contains the all. It contains the four marriages. It contains the complete petition of the kingdom coming. So again, just desire, your desire will grow. Thank goodness. Love that. But you got to receive, or you got to believe to receive. And then when you believe to receive, you are just constantly, your only prayer is thy kingdom come. Thy kingdom come. Don't, it's up, and he says that, you want this to come fast? It's up to you. Keep praying for the kingdom to come. Love me with my love on the scale of me, which is what? That's a complete act. So don't sit there and think, oh, my act is only a half an act or a quarter of an act. If it's on loan, and God doesn't do a half act or a quarter act, he does a complete act. So no, we don't even need to worry about that.
Matter.
Everything is now, you are the child of light to call down this kingdom. Will there be other children that live in the kingdom? Yes, but, and they will be children of light because they will be children of the knowledge of the kingdom, but their task was not to call down the kingdom. You living right here on this side before the kingdom to come is your responsibility to call down the kingdom, nothing else. God knows their names and their numbers, and he knows how to get them to do what they need to do because it is the greatest gift and he wants it more than we do. So, I don't have to worry.
Well, there is this sentence, you know, I come back. You know, we are growing in love of the kingdom and the divine will, because the divine will and the divine love are always together. Mm-hmm. And she acquires the qualities of sacrifice that are needed in order to possess it.
Where is that
letting,
from?
In the beginning of today's reading.
Okay.
In the first, in the second paragraph, there is necessary to ask for it, and then there are three things.
Yeah.
You know, there is the place, she forms within herself the royal palace, she acquires the love in order to love it, and she acquires the qualities of sacrifice that are needed in order to possess it. Luisa has been participating in this divine suffering. You know, suffering that came was put on Jesus's humanity by his divinity. This isn't part of it.
You said it's the second paragraph.
Yeah. It's cost something, you know. It's not all, you know, redemption or, costs a lot.
Or does she dispose herself, or does herself the royal palace? Look for the word royal palace, and it's right near the top of the second paragraph.
By asking for it, one acquires love. In order to love it, he acquires dowries.
Yeah.
The sacrifice that I needed in order to possess it.
And as he asks, the human volition loses its ground, is weakened, loses strength, and disposes itself to receiving the dominion of the supreme volition. And he's not just speaking of you, he's speaking of all souls. And as he asks, as each one of you asks for the kingdom, the human volition, every soul will lose its ground, will become weakened, loses its strength, and will dispose itself to receiving the dominion of the supreme volition. And God, seeing himself prayed to, disposes himself to giving it. That's amazing too, that God disposes himself to giving it. Yes. The dispositions are needed on both sides in order to give our celestial right. gifts. How many gifts we want to give, but because they do not ask, we keep them in ourselves, wanting to give them when they will ask. Again, your greatest job is only to ask for the kingdom to come. And every time you ask, the human volition loses its ground. You want this to speed up, keep asking, and the human volition will lose its ground. Evil will be no more.
Our Blessed Mother says the same thing. You know, the picture of her hand with the rays? So those are the gifts that she wants to give, but we need to ask for them.
Yeah.
It's very similar.
You open commerce between the creator and creature. If one does not ask, the commerce is closed, and our celestial gifts do not descend in order to place themselves in their round on the face of the earth. There's a reading recently. You're not asking for yourself.
No.
This isn't about you. You're done. You're done. If you're sitting there worried about what degree, stop. You're done. This is about your brothers and sisters, your family, your even your worst enemy. This is about them. And it is the greatest sacrifice, the greatest thing ever to it's nothing else you desire but for the kingdom to come for all souls. Believe to receive.
Yeah. And tied into that is it's about God as well. It's about
right.
giving to God what he deserves as creator of everything. And that love that we talked about, she acquires the love in order to love it. Well, that's what we learned in the first 10 writings about the virtues is that, and you talked earlier about the saints. Maybe the saints were focused on only one virtue, and what he tells us is that in operating in this gift, we are the summation of all virtues. And what is the summation of all virtues is love, his love.
Right.
And so we have to give up, she acquires the qualities of sacrifice that are needed in order to possess it. We know that the sacrifice of giving your will up is a big sacrifice, but you're acquiring the qualities to be able to do that by continually wanting and desiring this gift.
Because he does the work.
He does the work in all of this. All we're doing is giving the disposition. There's that word again, disposition.
Paul
started out the whole seminar with the word disposition, didn't she?
Cooperate to his operating, and he does it all. You'll never know how many divine lives you generated till you get to heaven, but just know that you are generating divine lives, yeah. and that you're bilocated in every soul. That's how it is. If you're bilocated in every soul, you're calling down the kingdom. You're calling down the kingdom in every soul. You're done. So, you know, again, the children of light who are going to call down the kingdom, you're here and now. It's happening. There's cynicals happening all over the world. And it's, you know, almost comical if I can be as bold to say that, because I don't know what else to say. You know, a bishop here or a bishop there saying they're going to shut it down. Like, you can shut down generating divine lives because you told somebody they can't do something? No. No, you're very limited in your small thinking. And God's got this news. We were going to go through it. And, you know, just shows you, if he uses the example of what had happened to him in his preaching. And he was told to shut down. He was told to stop. He was threatened. He was imprisoned. Everything. And it took 3 years. And then he went through his passion and resurrected. He uses that as an example. And this is, that was volume what? 30.
30.
Which didn't come out to the vault, meaning it was never published. Think historically what had happened. Volumes 20 through 36 were never published. They were taken from Louisa's hands and put into the vault until our time, because it's your time to call down the kingdom. This is volume 30, and he's telling you, he's showing you the example. It took 3 years where his preaching. We've had 30 with these volumes are coming out. Of course, the internet has helped tremendously. And you're seeing more and more cynicals popping up. It is happening. You can't stop this, nor could you ever anyways, right? But I just, you know, leave on an extremely just incredible note that this is happening. The children of light are calling down the kingdom, and the divine lives are generating. Acts are being repaired. You are doing complete acts, but you got to know it. You got to believe it to receive it.
Yeah, and you're asking for it. And we just learned, if you haven't already, but you all have, because we talk about it so much, not only do you ask it, but there's a confidence that you know that comes into you as part of understanding this, the second and the third paragraphs that he talked about in this first writing, is they desire to give it and they can give it. And so if you're built on that confidence and you have that instilled in you, then it's going out and doing it in your mission. I mean, it's the fuel for the mission.
And if you don't, email us and I'll send you Father John Brown's video where he says, if you're not there, get there by tonight. There's no reason for you not to, if you've been disposed and you're not believing you're in the fourth degree, you better believe it by this evening. So if you want to see that video, we'll be able to find it for you and send it on its way, because he wasn't messing around. That's the one thing I loved about Father Brown, is that this was a priest who came out and said, no. You do, you will, you have from all eternity. From all eternity is what you learn in these writings. You gave your fiat in the womb of God, and now he's waiting for you to give it to him in time. Done. He knew who his children of light were going to be to call down the kingdom. So if you're doubting, just email us and I'll send you the video. If we weren't strong enough, we'll send you Father Brown. So.
Okay, I think we're at a good point to call our cynical to a close for today. Got ample information for the next couple of weeks, it looks like, so that will be good. So again, thank you everybody for being here and contributing and listening and just learning on your time, and we appreciate you spending it with us. So with that, let's go ahead and call down the kingdom. In the name of the Father, and the Son, and the Holy Spirit. Amen. Descend, O supreme will, come to reign upon the earth.
Descend, O supreme will, come to reign upon the earth. Descend, O supreme will, come to reign upon the earth.
Our Father, who art in heaven, hallowed be thy name. Thy kingdom come, thy will be done, on earth as it is in heaven. Give us this day our daily bread, and forgive us our trespasses, as we forgive those who trespass against us. And lead us not into temptation, but deliver us from evil. Amen. Hail Mary, full of grace, the Lord is with thee. Blessed art thou among women, and blessed is the fruit of thy womb, Jesus. Holy Mary, Mother of God, pray for us sinners, now and at the hour of our death. Amen. Glory be to the Father, and to the Son, and to the Holy Spirit, as it was in the beginning, is now, and ever shall be, world without end. Amen. May the will of the Father be known to the Son, and the power of the Holy Spirit reign in me. Amen.
All right. Thanks, everybody. Have a great week. We'll see you guys next week.
Oh, shush. Whoops.
Sorry. Shush. Shush.
No, it's my dog.
Sorry.
Mary, can I ask a question?
Yeah.
I have a quick question. Okay, so this new paper that you sent out this week, is that just starting this week? You finished the... Okay.
Yeah.
Because I missed the first 10 minutes or so.
Well, you got the videos. You can go out on YouTube and pick them up from the beginning. And also, also if you missed anything from last week, you have those as well.
Yeah.
Thank you.
Thank you.
Mary, can you send me the Father John Brown video to my phone? Because I want to send it to those guys in England.
Now I have to find it.
I'm going to ask him too.
Sorry.
You actually have to ask John. John has them all. So we are going to download them to our YouTube and just put them in a different.
We got to get that done.
We got to get it done.
All right. I'll say farewell to those that are on watching us on YouTube. We're going to close the recording. Thanks. Actually, I need to stop the recording.
Bye, guys.
Bye.
All right. See ya.